23rd, Thursday, and Finance Committee is here today to listen to the department managers and find out what they're doing, how they're doing it, and how much money they need to accomplish their tasks. So everyone would turn off their cell phones, and we'll go through our roll call this morning. I'm Dave Hurd, Chairman.
Bernie Pigeon, Vice Chairman.
Tom Worthen.
Glenn Lawrence.
Joan Fons.
Very good. And to start today, we have Derek Sullivan, our town administrator, and we have our police department. So,
good morning, Mr.
Welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for having us today. And as we're going forward, just so people watching at home understand, today the department heads are going over the requested budgets. It is not with the cuts that have been presented within the balanced budget. So it's to show the Finance Committee, as you said, what they do and what they need to operate. And I'm happy to have Chief Walsh here. He's, if you've seen over the last few years, he's been the one that's not going over his budget by hundreds of thousands of dollars. So we're happy to have him.
Thanks. You have the budget figures in front of you. I actually hope you think they're way too low. So, but the I think everything's self-explanatory. The last few years we have come in actually under budget, and hopefully we continue that. We're a no-frills airline. We really are. We're not operating with any frills. We're doing the basic job of keeping the people safe in town, and we're going to stick to that. We're going to stick to incrementally fortifying the police department with equipment, their cruisers, and the things that we absolutely need, but we might not need in bulk at one time. So we understand budget constraints, and we understand that's the best way to go at this time, is incrementally. Manpower is an issue, as always, for us. I presented a letter to speak with the issue of manpower, which is one of my greatest concerns. Because of the growing town, the town is growing, the population's growing. Not only is it growing in the off-season months, quote-unquote off-season months, but, our population almost triples in the summer months. So we're kind of unique in surrounding towns that way. But I wrote Derek Sullivan a letter, comparisons structure-wise and call-wise that you have in front of you. To area towns, and I picked towns that were basically the size of our town. You'll see that Wareham Police Department is handling over 53 to 54,000 calls a year, calls for service. Actually, last year's calls for service were 54,774 calls for service. That includes citizen-reported incidents, EMS calls, and other officer-initiated calls. There are 1,061 arrests and over 2,100 incident reports. The statistic that we're keeping now since last year is overdoses with the opioid epidemic. We had 135 overdoses and 15 related deaths to those overdoses last year, so that's it's really adding to our police work. This year alone, the overdoses, I believe as of last night, we're up to 22 overdoses and 4 deaths. That's just January and February. So it's unfortunately busy on that level. If you look at some of the other departments, population is pretty close. Middleborough, 17,000 calls for services. Dennis PD, 14,000 calls. Dartmouth, 34,000. Bourne, 19. Sandwich, 20,000 calls for service. Falmouth, 31,000 calls for service. And you look at their sworn personnel numbers, which most are higher than ours, and their structure is the structure of the department is more complex. There are chiefs, captains, deputy chiefs, lieutenants, sergeants, all with and patrol officers, all with different functions with the structure of the police department. You look at the Wareham Police Department currently, and we have a chief, two lieutenants, which we were happy to make. John Gerard was promoted to lieutenant this past year, so we've had the luxury of two lieutenants for a few months now. And Lieutenant Walsek, who was handling grants and things like that right now. Both of them are handling dual jobs. But there isn't a captain, deputy chief, and everything else there. So I moved one person to detectives. We now have four detectives when we had three. I still don't have a detective assigned to a drug task force. I'd like to do that. So there are things we'd like to do structure-wise that the budget just doesn't fit right now, and I don't want to just force the issue and go over budget. It's not the right thing to do right now. So if you look at our sworn personnel, on top of that, we currently have two officers injured, actually three officers out. We had a retirement this year, and one officer was dismissed from the academy, did not make the requirements in the academy, physical requirements. So it's a chase to keep filling the manpower. And I realize with budget cuts coming, it's going to be even harder to fill manpower, but I'll cross that bridge when I get to it, because we do need the manpower. We're constantly chasing to fill spots. What's kind of alarming a bit is that in one of my handouts shows you that in 1990, the Wareham Police Department had basically the same amount of patrolmen. We had one captain, two lieutenants, six patrol sergeants, and a detective sergeant. Three records clerks assisting with the records dissemination, and an administrative assistant. That's 1990. So we're actually below structure. From 2017, we're below the structure of 1990, which is not good to look at. But
those are the last pages in your
last pages.
Yeah. Last two pages in the handout.
But with that said, I'm proud of the police force. I'm proud of what we do every day. I'm proud of what the guys and girls do on a daily basis to ensure that everybody's safe. And we do respond to every situation that we're called for. And hopefully the citizens know that we give them our best response. And we'll continue to do that. No matter what the budget figures are, they will feel safe in this town. Equipment-wise, one of the things I wanted to point out is that we're at the capital plan items have been that were requested. Like I said, I've gone to the incremental route of requesting items and things like that. So instead of asking for 40 items, I might get seven today, and I might get seven tomorrow, and I might get... You know, we'll build up to it, and to stay within the figures. One of the things is cruisers are essential, of course, to have a safe transport for the officers to get to the calls, to safely get to the calls, and to safely handle calls that always require the cruiser. That's the officer's office on wheels, and it has to be safe as possible. We switched to the Ford Explorers, the all-wheel drive Ford Explorers, a few years ago, and it turns out that it was the right move to make. It's a reliable vehicle, and figures that we're showing as far as vehicle repair and maintenance, since fiscal year 2014, they've gone down every year, the amount of money being paid out for repairs and things like that. I think that the vehicles are more reliable, and I think the officers treat them a little different than the sport car type cruiser. But I think that's a good stat to look at, is in 2014, it was 56,000, it went to 40,000, down to 26,000 for fiscal year 16. And I think that shows that was the right move to make. I would like to have cruisers always coming in to replace the older cruisers. If you look at the cruiser line items, if you will, on the spreadsheet, mileage goes up pretty fast on cruisers. And when mileage goes up, the warranties get older and the repairs come in fast. So we'd like to always add to the cruiser fleet. If you go a few years without adding to it, you're playing catch up to a point that it's an unsafe condition. But we're doing well there. We're trying to catch up, and we have a couple Dodge Chargers left, and hopefully we'll be saying bye-bye pretty soon to those. With that, I'll take any questions or Derek speak on some of the other figures. But like I said, even with with whatever the numbers are, I'm confident that the people in Wareham will feel safe. If the numbers were a cut, if we had to face drastic cuts,
sorry, I'm late, guys.
I don't want any cuts that would affect the safety or make us have to make drastic adjustments to keep up that level, but we'll do our best.
Thank you, Chief.
Mr. Chair, before we start, I apologize. I did not introduce Cassandra, if you wouldn't mind, Chief.
This is Cassandra Cassidy, administrative assistant, and she's the right-hand girl.
It keeps you on course.
She is the steady hand, yes.
Very good, Cassandra and Chief. Thank you. No, we do appreciate the work you do, and we admire the fact that you've been able to maintain the level of coverage that you have within the budget that you've been given. It's a tough time for the town in a lot of ways, but you folks have done a great job. Everybody does appreciate the work that you do.
Thank you
very much.
Thanks.
And any other comments? A little bit about the budget. Let me go back on that. Talk about the expense budget this year versus last year. Like you've had some salary increases. Is that a contract negotiation resulting in that?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if you remember, we essentially at one point were almost 6 years in arrears with the Wareham Police Department, which with the Patrolman Sergeants Union. That union has separated into two separate bargaining unions. And almost as soon as we were done with that contract, it was time for the new one, which we're currently bargaining. The new one, if it were a three-year contract, would expire at the end of FY19. So we've done. There's now 13 units, collective bargaining units, and we've done 9 out of the 13. The remaining are the lieutenants, the patrolmen, the sergeants, and the dispatchers union.
So the work is not over yet.
No, it's sort of continuous, and that would mean that's why when looking at FY18, whatever we finish up with the unions, it's almost going to be a double bump to FY18 because it's going to be FY17 costs plus FY18 costs. That's why I'm really concerned. It's when we looked at the budget, anything that's below the number that the Wareham Police Department has requested is almost a double hit because we have to take into consideration those future contract increases. That's the problem with trying to be in the rear. So we did start, I would say, over, I think it's been almost a year now, bargaining with the patrolman union. So a bit of a tough road.
Right.
It's been going on long, Joe.
No. He just gave his presentation.
And you have some other expenses in the future. Looking at the station and repairs to your yard and perhaps even a new structure eventually. What did you end up doing?
All of what we do comes out of a 1971 building, by the way.
Yes. What did you end up doing with the generator? I know you had a problem.
The generator, we through capital planning, we were able to purchase a generator, I think it was the year before last, but we... the generator will be moved. I believe it might even come to help the multi-service center, the old generator. Mm-hmm. And we did have a new generator installed. The installation just finished.
Good.
A few weeks ago. We have a generator, and very happy about that. And we feel that it fills the needs for our police department and a few years beyond.
Very good. Obviously, you've looked at ways that you can conserve money wherever possible, and it looks like you've done a good job. I know from the capital planning point of view, you've been very careful about what you've requested and how you've requested. We appreciate that. But we're looking at a requested increase in salaries of over $100,000 and looking at increases about $100,000 in expenses, as I see that. Is there anything that the town should be looking at as to improve the efficiency of the department? Besides a new building and more new vehicles, but
on our side, we're looking at grants. We're always on the search for grants, and we have received grant money for different things, for training and for 911 grants and things like that. We, like I said, the concern is going to be the manpower, and the concern is trying to stay up to 2017 levels when we're actually not even at 1990
levels.
So if there's a way to increase the manpower issue, we're all ears.
That's your critical item.
That right now, yes.
All right. Thoughts, anybody?
I have a question. Morning, Chief.
Hey.
Sorry, I was late. See, on the seasonal, it seems that you have the money's dropped. Is that going to? Didn't we get a grant for seasonal last year? No, there's nothing available on that aspect.
No.
Is that going to hurt us? I know in 17 looked like it was 92,000. Now you're down to 68,000. Is that going to be less manpower for seasonal?
It doesn't. Affect the manpower. What I try to do is keep the manpower level up, but it affects the starting date.
Okay.
So they might start a little later in the season than we want.
Okay.
You know, we'd love to start them as soon as the weather turns warm.
Yeah, especially on weekends.
That's right. That's the goal.
Yeah.
That's the goal, and I'll try to do that a little bit, but to conserve funds, it would be just a later start by a few weeks. And
same manpower, later dates.
Right.
I have another question, if I may, through the board. You know, I look at the coin, sometimes I look at the flip side of the coin a little differently. You know, everyone says cut, cut, cut. Is there any way that there are any fees or anything that you have looked at that they might be able to increase, make money? How's that? I know everyone wants to cut money and save money. How about looking at it a different way? Can we make some money which will, in fact, you know, help us? You know, I'm not sure of the actual fees you guys charge for certain things per, you know, I haven't looked into it that much, you know, any gun permits or other permits, parking, not parking, but towing or something like that.
The gun permits are, the rate is set by the state.
Okay.
And it's $100 and it's for 5 years.
Okay.
The town gets only $25 of that.
Right.
And then that goes into the general fund.
Right.
Records, the records law has changed. So now we're not able to charge as much for records as we were. Like people coming in to get reports, we used to charge $1 a page. Now it's changed to like a nickel a page. It's
excuse
really
me, why is that? No.
The public records law has changed.
Okay, it's a law, okay.
So really for us, we're more of a, you know, service, so we really...
There's no really, not too exactly. many fees you guys charge.
Exactly. The fees we take in wouldn't affect manpower, it wouldn't affect coffee for the manpower, so.
Well, I was thinking of money in, we but made money, you could get money. That's how I was looking at it, you know, that's all.
And money's obtained through, you know, traffic violations and things like that. Traffic violations is done for the safety of the public, not to make any type of money, or I don't even want to know what we take in for that, to tell you the truth. It's done for safety reasons. There are no fees that come in that are related to, you know, geez, if we got more of that, we could put on two more guys. There's nothing like that.
Nothing like that available. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, we're often asked about essentially creating speed traps to generate revenue. So there's a little story out of a New Miami in Ohio, and it's a population of 2,200. They collected over $3 million in revenue from motorists after installed standalone speed cameras along one of its major highways. Great. Fast forward, but now the village of New Miami must pay back every cent of the $3 million it collected from the speed cameras, which were ruled unconstitutional in 2014. So, yeah.
I don't think you got that right, Derek. I'm serious.
No, the judge ruled it unconstitutional, not right. me.
No, but I think the way they were capturing the information was wrong.
Yeah,
something was wrong.
It was not the fact that it couldn't be done. They just say we're doing it wrong.
So you always have to be careful with those.
Well, the reason I brought it up, and I know that I've brought this up before, and people didn't like it. There are some places in Florida, like Stock, and my dad goes to Florida, and these speed traps where they actually pay the whole budget through their traps, and what they do is they trap all. I know it's whatever, they try to trap everyone out of state, you know, and of course we have a lot of the, I know it's all wrong, but it is the way that they do raise revenue.
I wouldn't be able to put my head on the pillow.
I hear you. But they do, some towns do it.
Florida's fun.
Yeah, whatever.
What is a communications officer?
It's a dispatcher. It's a communications officer, is a dispatcher. But we like the word the communications officer. They're highly trained professionals. They're trained in emergency, all emergency responses. They're trained in medical, how to provide the medical EMD information. So it's much more than the old fashioned dispatcher. These individuals are highly trained and very professional and well rounded. So communications officers, we have 8 full time and 1 part time right now. We'd like to add to that even, but right now there's a little freeze going on. So.
I can see you're faced with a difficult conundrum from a marketing point of view. Both you and the town administrator want to say you're doing a great job, which you are. There's no question about that. However, with the budget limitations are you able to maintain, and how do you tell the townspeople you're unable to provide certain services, so they have the feeling they need to provide you with the increased finances if necessary?
Well, unfortunately, on our end, it's when we respond, whoever we have to respond to really doesn't care too much about the budget situation when they call. They don't want to hear about the budget situation.
No, they don't. Correct.
At that time, they just want you there.
Yeah.
So they expect the services.
But when we're here sitting in a budget evaluation, we want to know what can't you do because we're limiting your budget. And it's difficult to tell a person you're going to be later in your response time, and they're going to complain because they have to wait longer when they have a burglary or something like that. In a marketing perspective, how do you tell them that it's a negative?
I don't.
That's what the conundrum is. How
right.
do you,
that, yeah, is, that is a conundrum, but I don't want any of my offices telling anybody how difficult it was.
Oh, indeed, no, of course.
And so we just do the best we can. It sounds simple, but that's what it is. We do the best we can.
But as I say, from a marketing perspective, you go before the floor town meeting, says, I want some more money, I need more money, there's money there, let's say, as an example. You have to have a selling point. You have to give the customer something. And if you give them better response time, that means,
right.
Well, you haven't been responding already. You're selling a negative with a negative.
Yeah, it's very difficult. It's very difficult.
And my response is, you know, my selling point would be, we're at 1990 levels in a 1971 building with reduced manpower that doesn't equal 1990.
I think we have to go with that approach because if you go to the realities of the response and all of that nature, that is a negative. However, if you say, well, okay, we're at 1990s, and we've got an increased population of 5,000 in that time frame, well, yes, I can take it in my head without thinking of a negative that I need more police protection because I have more crimes being committed.
Right. And 54,000 calls for service.
You have to show that, yes, you have an increased workload, but it's not impacting you negatively in your response to that workload.
It's interesting because you have, for example, the schools do how many pupils per teacher. And if you did how many, you know, per capita per police officer in the summer, you're probably talking on a shift if, on the minimum, if there's six people on it. So you're talking about what, 7,000-8,000 people per police officer?
Police officer.
It's not the numbers you want to think about. So if we can get down to a police officer for every 19 people, I'm sure we'd be great.
That'd be fine, yes. High five, fist bumps, the whole bit.
And you need a big building for that.
So. Great.
We definitely need a new building.
Mr. Chair, I know that we're coming a little bit over the 9 p.m. hour. We have Mr. Evans in here, and he's known for being verbose, so I'm sure he'll take up all his time.
I thank you very much.
Chief, thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the work that you do.
Thank you.
I know.
Derek, do you have any target date for when you might have your actual budget based on all the increases, Betty?
I've been fighting that. So, no, but everything's going good.
When's town meeting?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm getting
that
under control.
Sarcasm is unappreciated.
I have a...
So as long as I can get sitters, I'm okay.
A meeting on Monday that should
a year now. Yeah,
help steer the boat, if you will.
I've been in
the and then a subsequent one on Tuesday with some of the with the school and such. So those are going to be two important ones to see where we're headed. I need a vote from the unions to see what's, if something's going to happen with health insurance or not. And if it doesn't, but it's... We just understand where we have to go.
We didn't have it ready with the selectmen's approval and all. I appreciate it. If you just email it to me,
yeah.
And I'll start inputting into our spreadsheet.
And you need the... did you ever receive the line-by-line from FY16, the finalized?
But we'll get
no.
there. You know, such as life, you have to assess.
That's really what I'm looking for.
Right. The finalized FY16. I'll see if I can...
Exactly.
When I print it out through Vadar, it's... Did we give them to Vadar last year, or did we give them to you as Excel?
Excel.
I'm going to look at myself. Okay.
Delicious.
No, actually, last year, you gave us a thicker copy, which was the, as we went through the budgets here.
Yeah.
It had the previous years for each budget, and I use that to build a spreadsheet on it.
Gotcha, so.
But whatever, however it is, steal it, email it to me.
I'll see if Matt can do a data dump out of Vadar and see if we can get into Excel. Sometimes the formatting's so brutal, it's not even worth doing it that way.
I can figure it out. As I say, we're using the Excel spreadsheet.
Yeah.
The only difficulty in trying to download is sometimes, when you gave it to me, there was a lot of history, including line items you may have used.
Which are gone now.
Which, yeah, and I just hid them all.
Yeah, so that worked. I think that was a really effective document last year in the handbook. So.
Mm-hmm. It is, as I always categorize, just put out the information, let them read it if they want. If not, it's their choice.
All right. Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Dave Evans from EMS before us right now. Welcome. Thank you. Hopefully there are no emergencies while you're here.
No. We got somebody to take care of them.
All right.
Okay, I just gave you several handouts. The first one, the spreadsheet, is the budget breakdown. It's just line by line. The salary line is broken out by position. We have a slight increase in the salary line.
Slight.
That's due to contracted step increases. And this year we also added 4 lieutenant positions, because we now have 16 full-time people as opposed to the 8 full-time plus the 8 part-time. We were having a difficult time filling some of those part-time shifts, so we had to bump those positions up to full-time, which gives us now 24-hour coverage with 2 ambulances instead of the spotty coverage that we had with 1 plus maybe the second. So those are all at the first step of those new 8 positions. And the 4 top ones are the added, the same people, it just they got promoted to lieutenant so that I have some help overseeing the shifts. And as a result of that, there's a small increase in the overtime because the new people get time off too. And you can see the breakdown of what they get for vacation, sick, personal, and holiday time. Those are the same hours that all the town employees get. Just the vacation is different by years of service. As you see, the top people, those are 20, 30-year employees. The rest are all relatively new employees. And then as we're going down onto the operating expenses, if the lines didn't change, I didn't give an explanation. And where they did change, I gave a explanation of what's going on there. Like on the CMS, that's Cape and Islands EMS. That's an annual assessment we get for being part of the EMS group on the Cape. They assist us with training, hospital relations, and stuff like that, state EMS input. The next line down is the billing service. That has a slight increase because we've had increased call volume, and they get a percentage of our collections to do the billing for us. The next one is the training. With the additional staff, we have to have additional training hours. On the other purchase services, it's the same thing. It's because of increased call volume. That CMED fee is our radio system that allows the paramedics and the ambulance to talk to the doctors in the hospital, and we get charged per call from the sheriff's office to make that connection. And the other stuff is just, if we have new hires, we have to do physicals, we do psych tests, we do drug tests and stuff when they get newly hired. Licensing fees, that's for our ambulance service license and the vehicle licenses, employee recertifications, and our software license fees. Building and equipment, that just explains that that's the repair and maintenance of our building. We do our own repairs and maintenance out of our budget instead of out of the town budget. The medical supplies, that had a slight increase because with increased call volume, you use more supplies and medications and stuff. You've seen it with Narcan and Epi, the big price jumps on those things. And then down the equipment replacement, you have this handout about the group bids from Serped that the state this year requires each emergency vehicle or ambulance to have a IV pump, which calculates the drip rate and the flow of certain medications you use. And there's a 4 required, 1 for each vehicle. We have 2 of them that are in this budget. That's why it went up by 10,000. And then the other 2 are from the town meeting article that we had for the last ambulance, was purchase and equip. We knew this was coming, so we put a little bit more money in there to fund this. And the last item is the leases for the ambulance and the supervisor vehicle. This is the last year of a 3-year lease. And then next year we'll start again with a new vehicle, a new replacing the 2006 ambulance. On the page over here, it's on the department letterhead. That just shows a breakdown of the calls that we've had and shows mutual aid calls to both where we go to help another town and where they come in to help us and how much revenue we've made. So in 2014, we did 3,900 calls. We had mutual aid come in 185 times and we helped other towns 51 times and our revenue was $1.2 million. In 15, our call volume went up about 500 calls to 4,437. We went out to help other towns a little bit more, 83, and we called people in a little bit less, 142. That's because that's when we started doing the manning the second ambulance with part-time people. So we didn't have to call as much help because we had manned trucks. And our revenue was $1.463 million. 2016, our call volume was 4,581. We went out to help people, a big jump, 106 times, and a big jump down on other calls, other towns coming in to 116. And we were just shy of $1.5 million budget. 2017, the current, we've already done 650 calls for the year. That's on a pace to overshadow what we did last year in January and February, because we start on the calendar year for our calls. So 650 calls already for the year, and these are our slow months, so it's kind of hard to get a good grasp, but if I calculate out for the full year, we're right around the same number, but we haven't had our busy months yet. And we've already given mutual aid 13 times, other towns have come in to help us 4 times. And our projected revenue for this year is $1.73 million. That's pretty much what I have. I don't take any questions.
All right, I see that with your new ambulances, our mutual aid has switched around from receiving to giving, which is good.
Right, we have more reliable vehicles, not having breakdowns, and with the staffing now that we have more reliable staffing with the full-time staffing. So hopefully those less calls going out means more money that we take in.
Very good, very good. I know at one time we were supporting Bourne, I think, very
yeah.
MS. So we've made a good turnaround there. And I see that your revenues projected seem to exceed the
our budget,
requested budget, which is also a favorable item for this town.
Right, and all the excess goes into the general fund.
How have we done with collections? Are we
we're still up there. We're doing well. You can see with it 1.7, we're doing pretty well. I mean, we still have some that we have to chase, but with our demographics, you're going to have that.
We expect that.
And with billing, no matter what we bill, we have a higher rate than what's allowed. So Medicare, I'm just gonna round numbers out, say we bill $1,000, Medicare says that's worth $400 to us, and that's what you have to accept. Same thing with MassHealth, Medicaid.
Right.
It's even a lower amount that they
pay. They're all negotiated rates.
Right, and there's nothing you can do. You have to write off the rest of it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at our reports, you see that we billed $4 million, you had 1.8 written off. That's because of the Medicare and Medicaid that you can't bill that. But if you have like Blue Cross, Howard Pilgrim, or some auto insurances, you bill $1,000, they pay $1,000. So if we had that
all the way across the board,
mix, we'd be in very good shape.
Very good. Yes, Tom.
Question. Good morning. You say that there are certain, you know, prices that Medicare and MassHealth pay. Are those numbers still profitable, or is that, in other words, you say you bill for $1,000, you get $400, $600. Excuse me. Is that a loss, or is that still profitable?
It's probably a break even for us, because you still have to, you're figuring in the what you do for the person, the wear and tear on the vehicle, the employee payroll, their benefits, and.
So let me put it a little different way. You do a call, MassHealth pays you $400. You're saying it's a break even or a loss, or is there any profit available? Why do it?
Because we are a 911 service.
I understand, you know, okay, that's a bad question. But there's no profit to it on some of these
calls?
Yeah,
we make some money on it.
Okay, that's what I want to know. I mean, it's the percentage not as, obviously is lower, I understand
right.
that.
And being a municipal service, you have to go on calls whether they pay or not.
I understand. I shouldn't have said that. I don't know why I said it, but I understand. But it's still,
yeah,
it's
still
not
make,
a loss.
We still make
I'm
some
saying.
Money on it. Yeah,
it's
not as much as these other payers.
Right, but it's not a loss.
Right.
Now, may I ask one more question?
Go right ahead.
At one point in time, I had heard, maybe I'm wrong or maybe I'm not, that there's a lot of money to be made in transportation of people from nursing homes or hospital to hospital. Would it be profitable for the town to get another vehicle and have people who just do that, have a truck equipped, maybe not as fully as, you know, a full medical truck like you have now, something that's a little, I don't know if it's possible.
Right. The state requires you to have an ambulance with the same standards
okay.
for emergency and transport.
But would that be profitable? Someone said that we were giving away a lot of that work.
Well, we're in it for the emergency work. There's privates that do the transport stuff. And if you do the transports, you're going to have increased staff because you have your emergency personnel that are manned. And if you use them, it's at time and a half.
Do you think you could make money at doing it, is my question.
And it's we've had difficult times getting people to work. I mean, we've had part-time people, and you can't. They have other jobs, so they just don't want to work. It's just the way
so
it is.
So you're saying you don't think it's a
I don't
good
think
venture?
I think that the headaches involved might not be worth. It's just trying to staff them and getting, because you have to be, if you say you're going to do it, you got to be there. You can't just say, oh, we can't get anybody.
I'm just looking to make money. That
right.
was my
and
aspect.
You'd have to have
the question.
Increased staff with the benefits and everything else. I don't think it's worth it at this point.
Thank you.
Do you even have a third unit down there?
We have a third ambulance that we call in off-duty staff, or it's for when the other vehicles are getting maintained, we have a be able to maintain.
So it is fully equipped?
They have to be.
So it would qualify, as Dominic says, if you ran a part-time service, there's
right.
the potential for it, but you can't impact the first two because you don't want to take one off the road.
Right, and the amount of emergency call volume we have now, those trucks are running all the time, and it's sometimes you need more than two manned ambulances.
So you actually do use that third unit for emergency calls within the
yeah,
community?
Yeah, we'll call people in from home if there's multiple calls, and we've had to call in other towns because we're manning two, and sometimes you have five calls coming at the same time. So
yeah, so irrespective of the revenue, Dominic says it would be impractical because we're reducing our own service.
Right, and then it's just you're going to have to drive your manpower way up.
Mm. Yeah, well, excuse me, but I just happened to read an article saying that was, you know, just the transportation from nursing home to hospital for doctor calls and things like that, that it was easier work and as much money as emergency stuff. That's
well,
why
it's
I asked the question.
It could be more money because some of these people like the private companies.
Anything can happen, but a lot of times
the private companies, yeah, the private companies are in, they'll take you to court, and they have collection agencies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they normally are only taking people that they know can pay.
Most of those people are Medicare. Yeah, I understand the Medicare.
We wouldn't be able to be so discriminatory if you would.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep. What we do is, this is an emergency function. Right. It's a service to the town, and that's what it's designed to be. It's to get people to the hospital or to medical services in an emergency, and obviously from your runs, we have a number of them.
Yeah, I know that there are certain places that do that, like on Martha's Vineyard, the Oak Bluffs Fire Department will do off-island transport out of Martha's Vineyard Hospital and stuff because there's no privates on the island, so they bring people over in emergency situations from the need to go to Boston or something.
Yeah.
But they have enough people that they can do that because their call volume is a little bit lower, so they can do the non-emergency stuff, and they have additional staffing for that. But I don't think it would work here.
Okay, thank you.
And I do, there's one thing I'd like to call attention to is, and commend Mr. Evans. If you look, there's no admin or clerical type support. And he's, if you look around at the calls, he's at the calls as well. So we've got a pretty dynamic leader for the department, and I appreciate all he does.
That's great.
Mm. Very good.
Well, showing a profit, bro. Yeah, I got no problem with that.
Mm.
I'm in the profit.
All right.
Okay, I left a few extra copies here for the other members.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time and service.
Thank you.
All right. Good morning.
All right. Good morning.
We have Mr. Menard from Municipal Maintenance. I'm glad you could make it. Thank you.
Perfect. We might as well start. With this is pretty much an easy one. It's basically a level funded budget from last year to this year. I had to change a few things around to accommodate for the additional cost and outside contracting, where we hired contracting for custodians in the buildings and stuff like that, and we changed some things around. So that's why if you look at 17s versus 18s in the expenditure pile, you'll see them switched around, the numbers switching around a little bit to make it happen. And I basically believe that we can do the same job as we did in 17 and still, even though there's some increased cost, I don't believe that this should affect us at all in our services to the town, the way it's laid out.
Keep our fingers crossed. Yeah. Yes. Let's see.
The first paper there is the full line with the payroll and all, and the second, as far as the first sheet you got there, it gives you the total budget and salaries, overtime, sick, all that kind of good stuff. And the rest, the bottom section would be the expenditures. And that's where the definitions come through with all expenditure side.
All right, so you're keeping a level payroll.
Yes, most of the contracts had the 3%, a 0, and a 3. So this fiscal 18 would be for the laborers a 0, except for the two foremans. They believe they went with 2, 2, and 2. That's the only increase on that side.
All right. And, of course, we're always susceptible to snow and weather.
Mm-hmm.
We have to understand that.
I believe that was level funded is also too. I didn't get on that one. It's the 330.
Yeah, that will always be increased by a few thousand, just so we can keep on going into the red legally on it.
So, last question. Not to bring it up. How is our snow and ice? How bad are we?
Where are we?
Where are we? That's a better question. Where are we? That's a better question. Yes, sir.
Doing a lot better until a couple weeks ago.
Yes. Stand by 1 second. Right there, that's the exact numbers. Where we stay today.
Well, I was a little more pessimistic before. We finally got the numbers. So we budget $330,000. The snow and ice, just for anybody listening, is one of the, if you increase it a little bit every year, so more than the prior year's appropriation, it's one of the few, one of few items you legally allowed to go into deficit.
Right.
So we did increase this about $100,000, I think, a few years ago. We brought it up significantly, working with the DOR. It's still well below our 3 to 5 year average. So far this year, we've expended, out of the $330,000 budget, we've expended $451,357. And that would have been... There was also a full load, I think, we had to replace with salt.
Yeah, the salt last year, as far as we, Derek wanted to kind of wrap up the numbers at the end of the season for our town meeting, and so we weren't able to top off our supplies at the. We usually always, as the storms come, we fill the shed, the barn again. That way, we're always prepared for the next storm. But this was at the end of the season, so we. Took it that we did not top off our shed, so we started off in a little bit of a deficit with the salts this year, and that's why the numbers are probably a little higher than what it would have been.
Yeah, because when we looked at it last year, we didn't have enough free cash to actually cover if we purchased the salt and sand, so we did have to push it off to the next year. So, one of the unfortunate things of being poor.
And that's another thing, we're in the process of building a larger salt shed for we can have the capacity to buy the product in bulk, maybe purchase during the summer months and save the revenue that direction too. It might be an upfront bulk cost in the beginning, but we should be able to save money in the future when that facility is built. And hopefully by the, knock on wood, they're saying by end of September or latest by the end of October being completed, I hope. Everything goes well.
Good.
That's pretty exciting. So it looks like, just to let you know, we did finish up last year with a little over $1,050,000. Well, after October town meeting, a little over $1,050,000 in free cash. So we would have enough appropriation to cover the deficit. Plus, I think we held back at least $300,000 with the snow and ice hold back. So. We're doing better than we thought, and let's if we can find wood somewhere, knock on it, and that we're heading into spring. So. Mm. I don't think, and Mr. Chair, I'm sorry, I don't think very many people actually know what the Municipal Maintenance Department does. So can you just...
Give us an overview.
Give the rattle down of everything.
General maintenance of everything. To me, it's like the budget cuts. It devastates the community because we do. I mean, everything: the street sweeping, the catch basin cleaning, the tree work, the snow and ice maintenance. It's just all the building maintenance we do. The parks, the cemetery. It's quite an ordeal that we have to take on a day-to-day basis. Even just basic leaf cleanup in the fall and stuff for over 30 acres of cemeteries that we maintain. And it's a daunting task for the small group of people that we have. And I give them all the credit in the world because they've been getting the job done and for the small group of people.
You attend the cemetery committee meetings.
That's correct. That was this morning too,
Will you
yes.
Tell them to raise their rates.
I can try that. That's something that they go by other communities and other municipal cemeteries, and we're.
But you haven't had a change since 2004, David.
I know, and we're still in line with surrounding communities in, as far as they're charging. I can put a bug in the air, but that's thing. It's pretty tough
it's
to.
Not a lot of money, but it's it's sloppy management. Mm.
So next time there's a commissioner spot open, we're putting Tom on.
You don't think they'll go elsewhere if you raise the rates?
you get paid. That's money comes to you to offset your costs for those funds. Perpetual care ends up in offsetting your cost for the maintenance.
No, not really. We haven't taken any money out. The perpetual care is probably. the biggest myth there is. You pay $100 and then you're taken care of forever. If we could find that deal anywhere.
At 3% interest.
Actually, we discussed that this
morning. You live off the interest, correct.
We discussed that.
$3 a year, yeah, that's going to do it.
This morning, the finances on as far as the perpetual care, and that's money that can't touch by law, that, and we can only draw the interest. And that account right now is only at like $924, so it's not really nothing to, you can draw right now.
Not going to pay for much.
Yeah.
But what you asked for, Derek, is useful perhaps in our report, because what he does is transparent to practically everybody in town. The fact that my street hasn't been swept is one thing, but once it's swept, I don't care about it anymore.
Right. It's one of the few things, unless you have an issue, you take for granted what the department does.
Indeed. And the description you just gave us, I think, would be useful to expose what everybody sees as transparency. It gets done. Who does it? I don't know. If someone was by here, whatever, and...
Yeah, it's like I said, we got a small group of guys, and they hustle every single day to get the job done. Really appreciate everything they do every single day.
The enormity of taking care of not just the roads and all, the buildings and all, because sometimes there are many towns, larger towns, have separate departments that maintain the buildings.
Right.
That's all part of your responsibility.
Yeah.
I don't think people understand that.
Yeah, street lights also, too. That's another thing that comes under us, too.
Maintaining the school buses.
Yep, we just took over the transportation part, too. Yep, the maintenance.
Can we go back a little bit? Explain this to me now. You said there's only $900. That's the interest on the perpetual care?
Yeah.
Where does the money for the perpetual care, it stays in a bank account? It's not touched?
By law, you cannot touch that.
Yes.
What is the balance of that account?
It's got to be 300.
Yeah, $351 or something, I believe. I just looked at it this morning.
$350,000.
Yeah, a little over, yeah.
And so that money sits there. We can only use the interest off of it.
Correct.
And this is a state law, or a law.
That's a law. But think about it, Dom. If you use that, if we use that, that money would be gone as well. Even if you pulled $25,000 out, maybe if you buried, how many people do we get a year?
Average around in the 50s, 50, 55 people.
So let's say you get 55 new burials at $100 OAC, that's $5,500. Even if you only took the new amount out or something, you'd bring that right back down to zero real quick.
Yeah. Maybe I was thinking, obviously the interest, maybe if it was capped at like, $250,000, you could spend a certain amount and then leave it and then use it. I'm just trying to think, it just seems like a lot of money sitting there, which could be used, but, law is the law, I understand. I was just curious of how that actually works.
The cap's actually an interesting idea because it still holds you, keeps you honest, if you will, that you can't.
Say you cap it at $250,000, so whatever, you spend till that and then use the interest to it, it's just a thought. I'm not sure how it can actually work. It might be something to think about.
You'd have to look at it because this is, since it's statewide, there's some cemeteries I'm sure have a million plus dollars.
Yeah, a lot of money in it, bigger cemeteries, bigger towns, absolutely. Just thought it was
some cemeteries run guided tours.
That would be an idea.
Halloween.
Some of the monuments are actual sculptures.
Yep. Dave, what is your staff? How big is your staff now?
My staff now with the administration and everything, I believe we have 19. Right?
Yeah, so so you've got
I can break it down for you.
Yep.
As far as administration, we got myself, Glenn, Deb, and Mary, and Laurie, so we're talking five there, a mechanic, heavy equipment operators. That would be, shouldn't break it down on that one. HEO is 1, 2, 3, 7, right? Between all of them. 5, 6, 7. And then a truck driver, 8, and 5 laborers.
So when you have the, for example, the catch basin cleaning, the guys that legally can do that with the licenses are
Right now, we got two operators, Keith Cannon and Mark Debonese, that are have the legal licenses to do that, perform that job.
And we have approximately, what, 4,400 of those?
Need a license to clean it?
Yeah, special license to catch basin, endorsement to clean catch basins, yeah. And yeah, it was like 3,300.
33,
over 3,000, yeah.
Keeping busy all year.
Yeah.
and with the new act, we need to do those twice a year?
Yeah, that's what twice a year was the new MS4 regulations on that. It's supposed to clean these basins twice a year, which is impossible that we can possibly do that without hiring that out.
Two people to do it for how many basins?
3,300.
Times
twice
two.
A year.
So just do, even if, and what's the average time to clean a basin?
It depends if they're chock full or if they're, you know, partially empty. But, you know, average, these guys are only probably doing, you know, 20, 25 a day because it's chock-a-block full.
Which means you have to take the truck back and empty it?
Yeah, empty, go back again, you know.
It's shocking, probably sometimes they are sick or take vacation.
Oh, gee whiz.
Actually, moving away from indentured servitudes.
No, I think it's important that the town recognize the wide-ranging services that you do provide, because, you know, as long as no one's complaining, they don't care.
Yeah.
And when they complain, they want it done yesterday. And you've got to schedule your men, your activities. That's a tough job.
Yeah, some things it's you know, emergency things, situations, stuff like that. You know, like a pothole or something like that. There's certain regulations that we have to have that done within a, you know, certain 3-day period and stuff like that. That we have to really get on for claims. Then the town's liable for that type of thing if we don't have them repaired in a timely manner.
Right.
And you impact it. You have 19 people. You take yourself and your secretary. That's two. Now you're down to 17. Two people with the catch basins. Now you're down to 15. To do all the rest of the work.
Four mechanics. Don't forget
yourself. Okay, and the mechanics and all. And you have people dedicated to do certain
jobs,
things
yeah.
That have to be done. And you don't have too many left over.
No, it's a small group, very small group.
Yep.
For a town this size, it's...
It's small.
Yeah.
When he takes his shirt off, that's a big yes.
It's and I'll tell you one of the issues that comes along with Mr. Menard being so efficient and a great department head is more stuff seems to get heaped upon him. So it's when we start thinking about having municipal maintenance take over things, we need to realize that at some point you'll make it less efficient by heaping too much on the department. So. We need to, any sort of changes going forward or even any sort of mergers, we really need to look at the command structure of that department as well, because I don't want to lose how we're operating now just to show some sort of change, if you will, so.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of the services these departments perform are transparent to the townspeople, to the people who are in town meeting to cast their votes. Somewhere they have to be made aware that these services are being performed. There are people there that have to physically do them.
Right.
And they have to understand that they're not transparent. They don't just happen magically.
Take them away, they notice.
Yeah, I think the people generally have noticed even decline over the years that, you know, as far as, you know, cemetery grasses don't get cut as often, or, you know, the beaches haven't been cleaned on a 7-day-a-week basis like they used to be and stuff like that. There's been some things that people, I'm sure, have noticed that, you know.
I can't tell you how many calls we get that say, well, it only cost you $1,000, or it only take a day to do it, or it only... Yeah. So what's 1,000? What's how many days is that?
Right.
You know, so it's...
Well, 2 years ago, when we had the 4th of July, you had to provide your staff to clean up after it. I went down there the following day, and you wouldn't know that a function of that size had taken place because your people had cleaned it up so well.
Yeah, get there early.
Okay, you do a great job, fine. You got plenty of people. What do you mean? You get the whole thing cleaned up? It's done perfectly? What do you mean you need more people?
Yeah. That was like a 5 in the morning. We use office staff, everything, even the girls in the office are pogey sticking, picking up trash and everything. That's how we get the job done. And utilizing other departments, you know, water pollution laborers, you know, harbor patrol, anybody that will join in the crew to help, we try to get on board to get things done.
As I said last night, Derek, yeah. I'm disappointed with your success. Because I can't sell it.
The department heads all do a great job, and they've, you know, Dave's been doing from day one. We brought him up. He's been doing a great job. We've had department heads that have been here for years, so I think this town's been very lucky with the staff that we have.
I think we are, definitely.
Appreciate that. Thanks.
What's on your equipment wish list for 18?
18. I would like to replace one of my sanders that we had. It was scheduled for this last fall town meeting, and all you know that we had a bucket truck that caught on fire, so we had to kind of swap that at the last minute to replace the bucket truck. So that's something I'd like to put on the
sanding truck.
Yeah, to get that replaced. And if all this private road things, that a road grader might be coming up to as far as something that for a need.
Hey Dave, what about surveillance? Are you doing?
That's already in place. We had some grant money that got approved for that, and also Matt had some funding also for that in capital, and we're going to get it done. That's on order, and we should be getting that done shortly.
And the current grader that we have, can you just give an idea of what we're...
Well, it's a 1989 dresser, and that they went out of business the same year we purchased the grader, 1989.
Got a wonderful deal on it.
Yeah, it was cheap. It's Komatsu actually took over the dresser product, and we were still able to get some parts for it, but not all. About maybe 15 years ago, we had an issue with the rear differential on it, and they had to machine the parts. It was like $40,000 to repair the thing. And now at this point, that was 15 years ago. Now, if something catastrophic like that happens, I don't think we're going to be able to. It wouldn't be cost effective to repair it any longer. It would be down and out. And what we're doing with it now, it's, you know, grading here and there, but if it gets onto a more of a daunting task that we're out there even more,
it's going to get more wear and tear.
It could possibly
maintenance
go down.
They resolve.
That's a $250,000 to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
That's a smaller one. Yeah. I look at $350 for something of the size we need.
If you want to set it up correctly, you look.
How many days a year does it use?
Depending on the weather. If it's like this, you get the frost in the ground or anything like that, we tend not to use it, but it gets used for snow plowing purposes, opening roads and stuff like that. And it's a year-round piece, but it's not, I wouldn't say, I could say it goes out, okay, it's 3 days a week or something like that. Some weeks it'll go out 5 days that week, and other weeks it'll sit there for 2 weeks or something until we're at the cemeteries mowing grass. And this is how we kind of, we try to perform one job, get it, you know, okay, we'll grade this and try to get all this section or area done. Then we'll move on to, the next project. Or if we, like, again, emergency, like we had instances where a post office refuses to deliver mail on, say, Station Street. So now we have to make an exception to the rule. Okay, we got to get that schedule in there for these people who can get their mail. Let's get that road graded in a timely fashion. And we're still limited to by weather. If it's like torrential downpour, you can't go push mud and stuff like that. So it's all by Mother Nature.
What is Carver, Rochester, Marion, Bourne have? What do they have? Same thing? Same graders? How many graders are in the surrounding community?
Geez, I'm not even sure if Rochester has a grader, to be honest with you. I don't believe. I'm not sure if the guy. I'll go around surrounding towns. I think we have enough of our own dirt roads to maintain and to be able to.
Well, I mean, if it's down for 2 weeks.
Yeah. It's just personnel, yeah. As far
you need someone to operate it.
Yeah, somebody to operate it. I don't know if you want to stick anybody in that ain't skilled in something like that in a $350,000 piece of equipment, you know. to hire it out.
Dominic?
I have a question. I think it's maybe more for a town administrator. Have we ever looked into, see the water bill here, you know, $20,000. Have we ever looked into whether or not the districts would, it would be feasible to get free water? I know that they pay taxes on their buildings. Now, have you ever looked into whether or not, you know, if you know, we didn't charge taxes for their buildings and, you know, we use their water, whether or not we would make out better, you know, whether or not the district would say, don't charge municipal, you know, don't charge the water, Derek, but yet, and not, you know, charge them real estate tax. If that difference could benefit the town, has anyone ever looked into that, whether or not it might even be legal or feasible, Derek?
I don't think we charge them real estate tax.
Why are we getting charged for water? See what I'm trying to say? I think that they should really, the town should not pay for the water. But what we give, you know, I mean, the fire, you know, we take care of the roads that they use. I mean, the fire department and everything, you know, they benefit from everything from the town, yet they're charging us for our water. Now, here's $20,000 that he could use for many different things that I don't really believe we should be paid for. This has been in my craw for a long time, and I've mentioned it before. I don't know if anyone's ever looked into it. I don't believe that we should be paying for water from the town that we do things for.
You probably see a vein pulsing in Dave's forehead right now because you're hitting on something. It's we get hit for turn on, turn off. So when you have the beautification committees and the garden club, and they tell you, well, just turn on the water. What's the big deal? We get hit with those. We get hit with the cost.
We should not have to pay for none of that stuff.
Yeah, it's.
And I think someone should really get into to trying to pursue that avenue. Put somebody on it to pursue that avenue. We should. That's crazy.
I've been working on it, to be honest with you. I've tried with the Wareham side, and I'm still trying with that. Onset, I got a meeting. I'm trying to get a meeting with him next week. They just waived. We had some charges from Hammond that, you know, a pipe broke, and it was some extra additional charges for the water and stuff. So they granted that to us. I just actually got an email this morning on it, and so Onset Water is willing to work with us as far as maybe we're going to talk about not charging him for like road opening fees and stuff. So I'm working with him, and maybe getting the water, like, you know, the garden clubs and stuff like that that we actually pay for, let them absorb that cost, and we won't charge, you know, the road openings and such that. So I'm in the process of trying to with yeah. Onset anyway.
And I think that, you know, it should be justification. And if they don't really want to work to you, that's something that they want from you guys. Don't do it. You know, push them up against the wall, because this water fee to the town has been something that's really eating at me, and it's really bothering me. It's a lot of money we can save, right, Tom?
No.
I mean, you think I'm wrong?
The citizens are going to pay for the water. I mean, I don't care whether they're getting on their water fee or they're going to get it on their.
No, I don't believe that. They're going to raise the rates?
it's the cost for the town.
No, they won't raise the rates.
And you got to look at it on a larger basis than just me versus them.
I don't think they're doing this together.
They're going to spend $20 million to do some magical thing to their water system anyway over the next 5 years. I mean, I know what you're trying to do. If we want to charge Marion, fine. But if we want to charge, take it over to our
I don't
own,
think
the town, same pair
the
of
town
pants.
Shouldn't pay for our own water.
Do they charge us for an ambulance, for a fire truck when an ambulance goes out? Because every time we send an ambulance, they usually send a truck.
No, we had a meeting on that one time, and it's especially now where they used to help us by backfilling on some of them, that really isn't happening. They're probably, if they were not responding, their number of calls would be dramatically lower.
But what I'm getting at is that they're not paying us when we have the extra personnel on site to assist our paramedics in...
Behooves them to go to those runs.
But they don't charge us for it.
No.
Okay, we get free manpower then to assist. We don't have to send our own trucks because we're not running the fire department.
Right. It behooves them to go to those runs. It's a good justification.
It's always good to have backup.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Very good. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
And thank you for all the work you do.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Buckminster, thank you for coming in to see us this morning. As you know, and if you seem we're talking about what the various departments do, you have a diverse range of activities that seems to be expanding like everyone else's all the time. So if you could tell us a little bit about that and then your budget needs and changes, we'd like to hear about it.
Well, good morning. Thank you also for, again, for last week. They're actually in the last 2 days outfitting our heating system. So
you
thank
almost
you on
have
that.
Heat.
We almost have heat. They might be done today or tomorrow. But anyway, when you're looking at our budget, we do have some number changes that were submitted. Basically, what we're looking to do, this is animal controls.
Okay. Do they have this one? Or?
No.
No, we don't. If you have copies, we'd appreciate
Absolutely.
Them.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, nope, thank you.
See, tell him again with the water, $1,400.
This is a sore note with me, too. the water and the sewer is, I don't know why I have to factor into my budget. And
shouldn't have to pay for it.
Anyhow.
Did you put a buck and a quarter over there for when you took the coffee?
You want a bucket of water?
You'll see the breakdown from FY18 to 15 to 18. My request this year has increased, and the reasoning was we have been in discussions about how we could streamline a few departments into our department, and one of them was looking into a Department of Natural Resources and trying to see where we're going and what else we can offer the community and managing more on the animal control end of it and expanding into, you know, the illegal dumping is growing, trespassing, ORVs, all of these different things. And we've been looking at a few communities that are around us that are like size, and they're going to this basically one-stop shopping department, which covers all of these avenues. The figures that you're seeing for the increase was that I just carried over animal control's budget into my budget, and it does add another Department of Natural Resources personnel person as well as an assistant animal control officer, but that gives you that would expand our animal control coverage 7 days a week, as well as all of us would be certified as animal control. So you actually have now a natural resource officer that can cover animal, marine related. They can do the parks, the recreation end of it with the parking. And we're just trying to get the biggest bang for our buck out of the personnel that we have. I know we're in some tight times, and this obviously can be adjusted as we see fit. But I can go through the numbers a little bit and discuss the breakdown of what we have for personnel currently, and we're only adding one person into this. We've eliminated a part-time clerical person, so the funding that we were already that was already put in our existing budget would take that portion of that part-time clerical and turn it into this natural resources assistant. So I do have a breakdown of just a layout of what the natural resources would entail. I can do it now. Thank you. This is just basically a nutshell until we really get the proposed, because we have to have some public hearings and whatnot, but you're probably going to see it on the special town board. This will also give us an opportunity to look at some different ways of generating revenues through fines, enforcement, different programs that we can offer. I think if you have an extra hand, especially with animal control, where we used to have rabies clinics, and we used to push a lot of different outreach programs to try and public awareness with animals and wildlife. We can kind of get that together again with the groups that we have. So currently right now we take in $433,000 in a variety of income revenue generators, and that doesn't include the, I think it's almost $180,000 with the parking program. And on top of it, our first year, our parking citations were pretty substantial. This year, I think we're probably going around $20,000 a year in parking citations that our personnel is writing, not including the police department. So so that'll put us up around five and change, as well as the additional revenues generated for what we get back on the parking citations. Between the launch rentals and the mooring rentals, because it's a combination now when you purchase, we went to an online mooring reservation service. We're brushing about $9,000 in rentals with the launch operation. So it's over the last 3 years, it's grown in popularity to the point where our first year we had about 400 passengers. Second year we did around 1,800. This year we hit 2,600. So with this steady climb of this launch operation, I think we're still moving forward with it. So we looked at a 5-year as really setting this thing into Onset and getting it going. And now Brewery Yacht Yard that purchased Onset Bay Marina has now been purchased by Safe Harbor. So they're part of the largest marina network in the country. They are now promoting our launch service on their website, their customer mailing list. So everybody's starting to see that the service is really benefiting people, and it gives them a little safe opportunity. That's the smallest operation we have, but it's the newest one, so it's exciting to have. So I like bringing that up was one of the they said it couldn't be done, but it's not huge, but we did it. So now, well, to the big ones. Our transfer station issue is touchy right now, but we're generating around $193,000 a year in combination stickers, and that includes the senior stickers, that includes the $50 guest passes, the $5, what were they? We got so many permits here. The 1-week pass, the 2-week pass, the daily pass, senior rates, placards, those are for the guests that if you go to Little Harbor, you get the little hanger in the window. We sell $8,900 in placards. This year was the first year we've ever sold out on these combination stickers. We've never hit this number of stickers sold. So we had to restructure and increase our sticker production. to cover that. So the Onset parking program, the sticker program itself, it generates enough money to cover its costs. That's the parking program where you have to have the resident sticker in it. So we average around $10,000 between the $5 passes and the actual sticker passes. And we also offer business passes and contractor passes. So Tempest Knob generates $12,000 a year for parking. So we are showing that we're looking at different avenues, and it's not substantial money. We're looking at dinghy docks. Our dinghy dock sales are around $1,700 because they're only $50 permits. I'm sorry, $75 permits. We have floating dock permits for $900, and what was the other one? Obviously the harbor service permits is our other number two biggest generator, and we do about $170. With the launch services, we bring in about $173,000, and we're looking at looking at some different fee structures, and we're not sure what's going on with this transfer station yet, but that's something that we're going to have to. We can't go backwards on that issue. So my animal control budget that I transferred in, I did reduce their expenses into our operating budget because I think we can absorb what our current budget is. Some of their expenses, so we were able to drop down a few figures, not substantially, maybe a couple $1,000s, if that. But Over time, I think I think if we can look at how our department can offer more to the town for and still operate with it pretty much within our means, I would I'd like to see what the town thinks with it, and if it doesn't work, we'll go back to our original our two department budget and animal controls budget with the police department.
Very good. I like to see us doing more with less, or more with better utilization of our resources, and it looks as though we're making a good effort to do that.
We have our staff, the two assistants, Michael and Jamie. I mean, they're really and even the seasonal people, Marietta down the office. I mean, the dedication's there. They put in a lot of time where they're not paid for it. It's just we do it because we do it, and it was. One of those things that we tell everybody when they come into this, it's not, you're not a 40-hour week job. This is a marriage. So you're in it to win it. So it's they really, you know, there's days that they'll put in 2 extra hours a day, 3 extra hours a day, and it's just something they do. It's so I cannot complain about what we have going on. I have little to no resistance with these guys on ever wanting to do anything. You know, I come up with some pretty crazy ideas, and they're like, "Oh my God, we have to do this," you know. But they go right through it.
Build docks and
yeah, we just put out a mega upweller, which is it's our pride of the fleet right now for our aquaculture, and we actually took two old docks that we were using currently, and through funding that we received through Bouchard Oil Spill, and we've had some fines that we've collected through. EPA regulation violations where we benefited from it. We were able to build this 30-foot shellfish upweller, and it's got 16 silos. It's got two discharge pits in it, and we're going to grow over 1 million oysters in this thing this year. So and we have more funding where we're building 3 more upwellers for. We're assisting Dartmouth, Fairhaven, and us, because we're the only ones that actually have a facility that can do this. So we're building shellfish upwellers for all these other towns now to be able to benefit from the same monies that we got, and we're partnering up with them. It's been nice to see, let us reach out to a couple of our neighbors here and provide some assistance. Great. But you know, we'll have a second upweller up built next probably 2 weeks, and we're going to attach them. We've designed it so they all lock in together. It's one large working platform, and that one will grow quahogs, as well as all of the other funding that we received for, we've got 4 or 5 different projects coming this year through requests that we put in. So it's busy. We're stretched right out.
Well, in your spare time, you've been going after grants also.
We got to find some new stuff, and Onset Pier is a major concern.
That's a major concern.
We have a few things. I mean, we have to look at, do we invest in the engineering and make this a shovel-ready project and sweeten the deal towards other opportunities? We looked at trying to find funding to pay for that, and that fell through because it didn't meet certain criteria of sea level rise and storm protection, things of that nature, where it was just a pier. So that we tried, we fit in some of the criteria, but ultimately we did not win on that one. So we have all the paperwork in place now, so our engineer can actually just keep pushing it into future potential funding sources. So the pier, do we have to look at, do we want to update it? Do we want to modernize the buildings? What do we want to do? And I think that's going to be something that we really have to jump into at some point. So.
Well, that's something we hope our master planning will get involved in that also.
Yeah, and the new town planner is great. He really is. He's a great guy.
Good.
Well, that's it's interesting because people they wonder why we have a year-round operation. I think you just heard about it. It takes the whole off season to get ready for the season and everything they're doing. And one of the interesting, we all live in New England for a reason, and I always say it's for the summers, and it's his busiest time of the year. So,
right.
I think he's nuts, but that's okay. We like him.
Myself.
Very good.
Gary, when you get parking tickets or beach tickets or whatever you need down there in your office.
Yes.
Can you do that online as well?
We can't do it online, and we looked into it. We have a lot of people that will come in with altered registrations and all sorts of fun things. A lot of people, just before they move, they come right in, they buy the beach sticker, and then they move out of town. So there's nothing we can do. Those are loopholes. And Town of Bourne does it. You can do 1 year, and then the first year you can actually go and you have to go in and buy your sticker, and then you're in the system, and then you can renew it the next year online.
Okay.
But I mean, it still comes down to, we have to package it, we have to mail it, there's still other expenses that come along with it too. So I mean, we'd have to factor all that in. And I sat down with the Town of Bourne director, and he said it is a nightmare. At some point it would be great if we could do that.
It's just more convenient for the people.
Yeah, and our credit card service is it can be interesting. I mean, it's not like you go into a store and you swipe your credit card and it says, is this amount okay? You hit okay, and then you sign and you're done. It's, we have to take all of your information, enter it into the system, process the card, enter your driver's license information into it, or your residential information into it. Then we print you a full page receipt that we end up having them sign, and then we keep that. So they can get an emailed copy, but it really, I know we've been looking at a couple of things. At some point, I think that needs to change. But
I wasn't looking for saving money. I was looking for convenience.
Until the system gets a little more advanced, I don't think it's convenience, unfortunately. Coming in and doing it is pretty much it. But yeah. You know, the best thing that we've had run through was this DOCWA program, where it's that online mooring app, and we literally, I get a text message saying this person wants to reserve a mooring for 2 days. I hit accept. We get money deposited into our account, and we write a nice note saying thank you very much, and we're done. So, and then the office processes the payment, which is it's great, because they do get the company actually handles everything, and then it gets deposited, and then we have to transfer it into the accounts accordingly. So, if we could mimic that.
Yeah, Gary, getting towards the shell fishing. Now, are there many fees for people who are shell fishing without licenses? Are there any fines? How are we doing with something like that?
We do fines. I mean, a lot of it is,
I know, like weekend people and
we write some citations. We don't really hammer hard on the citation.
Right, you just tell them what to do.
Because when you really start figuring out, and I'm not trying to get out of holding people accountable.
No.
But once you, with our citations, if we write a $50 citation, you spend your time writing it, then everything gets appealed, so that person has to go to court, and then actually, you know, it's costing the town money on top of it. But it sets a precedence that we're not playing games with it either.
Right. One other question towards that. Now, I'm not sure that I know much about, you know, how the Wampanoag, how the Indians are able to do anything. Now, they can shellfish all the time.
Yeah,
But now, what I read up on is they can shellfish for their own and for their family, but they can't sell them. Am I correct?
It depends on what definition of sustenance you read. So,
because you know what I'm talking about. In Onset, you have this guy, he shellfishes every single day, and he's uptown selling them. Now, I didn't think that was legal. I know that the Indians can shellfish for themselves all the time. But he's depleting, you know, one of our smaller areas, and he's profiting from it. And I didn't know if that was legal or not.
It's the system itself is very touchy. And we try to make sure that we respect the Aboriginal rights
to
fish. Selling is not supposed to take place. However, you have to see the physical exchange. That's where it goes. And when our process is, we go direct to Division of Marine Fisheries if we have an issue, and then the Division of Marine Fisheries approaches the Tribal Council, and we discuss the situation. So we try to be very diplomatic with it. And I know that situation.
The guy's there every day. Yeah.
We have spoken with him and the Tribal Council about that, and it's frowned upon for what he's doing. So,
But no one's stopping him.
No.
Browning is different, but depleting a service for other people isn't what's happening.
The amounts that that gentleman's harvesting is not as substantial as some of the other individuals that come down and harvest.
That's the only one I see.
We'll have a few that come down and harvest bushels. It's an all day affair, and it can be damaging. But
They can even harvest in closed areas. Am I correct?
No, they can't.
They cannot.
They don't have to abide by town regulations. We ask as a courtesy if they could make sure that, you know, in the recreation areas and areas that we're trying to rebuild, that they not fish as heavily. But basically, unless an area is closed by the state for contamination reasons, or it's in the best interest of a health issue, they can harvest. So.
Thank you.
No problem. Yeah, I'm sorry.
No, I know. Don't get me wrong.
We truly try to respect everything that they have an opportunity to utilize through their rights. Yeah. But the selling is a tough situation. But
no, I know it is, and I know luckily, you've worked on it before. And I've talked to you before, and thank you.
I would like to see if they were going to go that route, that the state would issue them a free seller's card. At least that way they know there's some accountability and they know where stuff is being harvested. That's one of the options. So.
Very good. Anyone else? All right.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
All right. We're going to take a short break.